Praise the Lord. My name's Tom Black, and I have a testimony. I grew up in Chicago Heights, 49 years old, and I grew up in a town. I didn't know one Christian. I didn't know those Bible guys. They were on the TV, and I never knew one personally. All my friends were Catholic. I grew up in a Presbyterian church, and in a home where the name of the Lord Jesus Christ was never mentioned, maybe once or twice my whole life. And because of the burdens and the fruit of corruption that was growing up in my life, in 1992, a Hiles Anderson College student knocked on my door as a result of prayer. I prayed, and I said, God, I need some answers. If you're real, I'm going to look into you. If you're not real, I'm going to look into some other things, you know. And thank God, my life didn't go that way. And so a preacher of righteousness knocked on my door, gave me the gospel, and I got on board. I got on board fast. You know, I was blown away when I went to First Baptist Church of Hammond, Indiana. I couldn't believe families were together, and families were smiling, and children were singing. And I didn't know one scripture. I didn't know one hymn in the hymn book. But I knew. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And so within a year, I was enrolled at Hiles Anderson College. You know, a year before that, I was a long-haired, heavy metal rocker, and it's kind of embarrassing, but that's where I came from. And so those Hiles Anderson ladies, like my wife, they had no idea that, you know, when she was praying for a husband, if she would have saw a picture of me, she would have been like, God, no, not him. So anyway, I mentioned all that because I love my Christian heritage. And in my handout, I go a little bit more into that. And I love Hiles Anderson College and the fact that they're soul winners and the fact that they're reaching the Tom Blacks that are right here in this community, too. This soul winner, if you will, he knocked on my door. He had no idea that God was already preparing me circumstantially so that I would bow my head about 30 minutes later and just call on the Lord Jesus Christ and ask him to save my soul. And I did that, and I'm so grateful. God's given me a family, and my life is an example of the power of the transforming gospel. And so... So I did. I went to Hiles Anderson College for 4 years, and boy, I tell you, you know, I believed everything I was taught, you know, and even to this day, I'm really grateful for Hiles Anderson College. Like I said, they're soul winners, and that's the most important doctrine that there really is. It's the gospel, and so everybody in this room should be an expert on at least one doctrine, and that is how to tell a person how to get saved. Because, you know, when you know how to tell a person how to get saved, you never doubt your own salvation. Right. You know? And I met those people. Oh, you know, every few years they're wondering if they're saved. But, you know, if they're out going telling people how to get saved themselves, you know, sinners, there's a penalty on sin, and that Jesus Christ is the answer, and if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. I mean, that's the gospel in its simplicity right there. And if we're out in the highways and the hedges compelling people to come to the marriage supper, then we're never going to doubt our salvation either. So, like I was saying, I really place the most evidence on the most important doctrine, which is salvation by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And when I was at Hiles Anderson College, I'll tell you one thing they just taught us is to get out in the highways and work and work and work. But you know, after I got out of college, I'm a reader. I kicked Hollywood out of my life. We don't have a TV in our house. And I just started reading and reading and reading. I was in the Bible a tremendous amount of time. And I was just wondering, why aren't certain things being taught? You know, what's going on here, you know? And all the messages where I went to college and where I went to church, they were scriptural messages, but there were some subjects that were never touched on. And if you're in this book, you know there's a lot in there that preachers never touch on. And I was that guy, trust me. When somebody come around me, you know, I'd get my mouth running. I'd be talking about that 5%. Nobody ever touches on, and they're all, oh, here comes Tom Black, that'll be third. So I'm one of those guys, I admit it, I'll raise my hand. My family will say amen too. So today we're going to talk about one of those things. And it's interesting how I met your pastor. You know, last year I was on the internet searching for pre-wrath independent Baptist preachers, and you know, most of them haven't come out in the open. And I the only reason I was able to find Brother McMurtry is because somebody else had linked to him. And I was like, wow, okay, he's 3 hours away. I called him on the phone, and it was like therapy for me. And I was like, thank God, that actually talks like me. He says the same things I do. And so you guys are blessed to have a pastor. When he gets up here, he's just reading scriptures, and you're getting fed things that I, frankly, haven't heard. And so until just the last few years. And so let's take a look at this doctrine of immanence. And so the first thing I'd like to point out about immanence, it's not a Bible word.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, if you look in the Bible for the word immanence, it's not in there. So that should be a red flag to the Bible student right away. And so we're going to have to go to a dictionary to find out what the word immanence means. And if you look, some of those pages are numbered, some of them aren't. I just kind of printed those out for everybody. If you look at the American Heritage definition, immanence means about to happen. Okay? And so, now bear with me if you don't believe like I do, because I've been saved 24 years now. And for almost 20 of those years, I believed in the imminent, any moment, return of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what I believe. But you know what? I can never defend it. And my wife tell you, I'm a motor mouth on all subjects, no matter what it is. But this is one subject that I just bit my tongue on, because I just felt like there's something missing in my understanding. And so I didn't have the confidence just to be the Tom Black that I usually am on all the other subjects I love to talk about. And so, but anyway, get back to the definition of immanence. It just means in the dictionary, it's something about to happen. But if you look at an independent fundamental Baptist website, and you look at what we believe, or you look at their church constitution, here's basically what you're going to get. Now, they vary from site to site or church to church, but this is the gist of it, and this is what the way I understood it. The fundamental Baptist doctrine of immanence means Jesus Christ could come suddenly at any moment without any prophetic event needed to be fulfilled beforehand. Is that basically what you guys understand immanence to mean? Because that's how I understood it. And folks, I'm here to tell you, it's just not true.
Amen.
And you know what? And so a few years ago when I discovered this, I started asking preachers, because I didn't want to switch a doctrine. I love my heritage, and boy, if I heard a guy say something like that a few years ago, oh, I would just tune him out. I'd be like, whatever he says after that sentence, I'm not even going to hear him, because we know he's wrong. He's probably not even Baptist, I used to think. But, you know, when I started looking into this was because in about 2012, a preacher of righteousness that had invested in my life, who I trusted, challenged me on this. And that's what it took for me. It took somebody that I actually trusted and that I knew, and I knew loved the Lord. It was a soul winner who bore much fruit for the kingdom of God. He said, now he wasn't talking to me. This was an interview with Kent Hovind in 2012. He was being interviewed from a prison cell. He said, you know, my ministry has been for creation and evolution for all these years. And he said, when I was in jail, I read the Bible through about 30 times. And I was pleading with the Holy Spirit on the end times, because he just couldn't reconcile certain passages. I'm like, man, that sounds like me. With the exception of I haven't read the Bible through 30 times, seeking the answer on this specific subject. And so, Kent Hovind, he didn't change me that day, but you know what he did? He pointed my feet in the direction to investigate the matter. That was in 2012, so I just started asking preacher after preacher after preacher the questions that he posed in that interview. And guess what? I discovered an anomaly among independent fundamental Baptist doctrine. It's that you could ask about the blood of Jesus, and they'll give you this verse. You could ask about the King James Bible, and boy, they're ready. And they'll give you the verses that we all know. And you could ask about the gospel, and they're going to get it right. Salvation by grace through faith. But if you ask about Bible prophecy, they're just all over the place. I mean, I've heard some really bizarre things even. And so I was like, you know, this is interesting to me as an analytical thinker and a researcher. knows, like, all the Baptists are in unity, in lockstep. They know all the verses on all these doctrines, but you ask them about imminence, you ask them about the second coming, you don't know what you're going to hear. And so God stirred me up to get into and we can't cover everything that's here, but I'm going to hit on the big ones. When I ask God's men to defend the doctrine of imminence, I wanted to know the best evidence. I didn't want to know, like, you know, a whole bunch of different things. I wanted to know, well, give me your best case, because I need to know it. And here's what I come up with after several years of asking ordained, fundamental, independent Baptist brethren that I've just loved and, you know, trusted all these years. And so, let's look at the first one here. Find in the booklet that I passed out, the best so-called proof for imminence. These are the ones that they threw at me. And they're not in order or anything, but these are the main ones. So the first one that I heard so much is the time is at hand. Brother Tom, the time is at hand. That means Jesus Christ could come at any moment. But what does the time at hand mean according to the scriptures? So let's look what this is here. In Jeremiah chapter 23 and verse 23, we see an example, and this is not just one place. Trust me, I could have made this very lengthy and went on and on and on. The Bible very frequently is its own best dictionary. You don't have to go to a secular dictionary. The Bible will define a word itself. And look at Jeremiah 23, verse 23. It says, "Am I a God at hand?" There's that little phrase, at hand. Saith the Lord, and not a God afar off. So here we have a verse that says, we have, I just thought of something. I didn't turn this on. Was I supposed to? I was supposed to turn this on. I messed it up. All right, brother.
It's all right.
All right, we're going to go midstream now. All right, it's not working anyway. Okay, so Jeremiah chapter 23. Defines that phrase at hand. And that's what has been thrown at me, not every time, but nearly every time that I try to back a preacher on the corner on, could you help me understand imminence? And so now look at Joel verse chapter 2 and verse 1. It says, "Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, sound an alarm in my holy mountain, let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh, for it is nigh at hand." Now, this is interesting. This is an Old Testament prophecy by Joel. He says the day of the Lord, which is what we all talk about in the end times, that's when the sun and the moon go dark, and that's when all the... He says it's nigh at hand. Does that mean any moment? Jesus Christ was never even born yet. How could that day be any moment? Because we know Jesus Christ had to be born. We know all kinds of things had to happen before. And so here we see just in the very first proof that it was thrown at me, it is easily shown not to mean any moment. It just means near. At hand means near. Okay, so let's look at proof number two. Thief in the night. How many have heard that before? Thief in the night. Yeah, everybody. We just had a... Boy, I don't want to say anybody's name and embarrass them. But we just had, I brought this message up to an evangelist that came through our church. And he said, you know, well, his morning message was great, and I talked to him afterwards. And, you know, I'm bringing this up to every single preacher I come in contact with nowadays. And I told him my story and tried to establish some common ground with him. And so that night he came back, and boy, he preached on... He wanted to show me that he was very knowledgeable on these things. And he kept saying, well, we know that Jesus Christ can come back any moment because he'll come as a thief in the night. You know, and I was sitting there, I was like, I shouldn't, you know. But anyway, I had to endure that. So afterwards, I approached him and I said, you know, that thief in the night. I said, do you know where that's found? Because you didn't quote the reference to it. And he just kind of looked at me, and I said, well, could you tell me what book it's in? And he's like, Matthew? No, it's actually found in 1 Thessalonians. Let's turn there. Let's look at 1 Thessalonians. Turn in our Bible to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Because this is probably the most common one that was used on me. And I want you guys to know that when a preacher of righteousness says Jesus Christ is going to come a thief in the night, he's right. But that verse does not teach him, and it's, I'm going to show you right here. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, look at verse 3. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Amen. But ye, okay, now we're talking about some different people here. Mm-hmm. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. Now, are you guys the brethren?
Amen.
Is that day going to overtake you as a thief?
No.
It's not. It is absolutely not. And he goes on to explain, verse 6, therefore let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep in the night and they that be drunken are drunk in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and of love. And on it goes. So folks, if somebody tells you that Jesus Christ is going to come as a thief in the night, you have to explain to him. You can take him to this passage. If Jesus Christ is coming as a thief, you're not brethren.
That's right.
And absolutely he is going to come as a thief. Brought his way to destruction.
That's right.
More people are going to look at Jesus Christ coming as a thief than the brethren are. Mm. But we are told to watch and be sober and to be looking with all the things Jesus warned us about, like in the Olivet Discourse and the Book of Revelation. And I wish I could go into those things, but let's stick on this doctrine of imminence. So the time is at hand. It just means God is not afar off. It means that it is near. It does not mean imminence. There is a difference there. And the proof number two, Jesus is coming as a thief in the night. It doesn't mean that he could come at any moment. It just means if you're lost, it's going to come as a surprise. Mm-hmm. And they're going to say peace and safety. And we're going to say, well, no, we're seeing this coming. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's move on to the second. Let me find a place here. Okay, here's another one. I had a preacher visiting our church. You're seeing a pattern here, aren't you? I mean, I love independent Baptist preachers, but this is my passion right here, and I love to talk about these things.
Amen.
And so proof number three, I had a pastor tell me, Brother Tom, you're looking for the Antichrist, and I'm looking for the blessed hope. Made me feel pretty bad, you know. It's like, I'm looking for the Antichrist. Well, that's just not true. You know, I was just like, well, you know, my little boy, he's looking for Christmas. He's not looking for Halloween, you know what I mean? So, Halloween's coming first, but, you know, they want those presents, so they're going to skip over the Halloween thing. So, basically, he just kept saying it over and over and over. I just can't believe that Jesus Christ would not come before this persecution of the saints. You know? And so it's a stumbling block. These things are just repeated over and over and over. And I believe them. And I personally used to get upset when people used to say the things that I'm saying right now. But I tell you what, hey, it's exciting what's going on right here in this church, because you know what? These things are true.
Right.
And you've got a preacher that's taking a stand for it. And that's why Tom Black and his family's here right now. Not that I'm anybody, but I've been, you know, actively seeking out somebody who's been like-minded, because I believe that these slumbering eddies in Zion, independent fundamental Baptists, are getting shaken up right now. And I honestly believe, this is not part of my lesson, I honestly believe that God's going to bless this ministry, and that things are going to be happening. So get on board and learn how to defend this. You know, don't say, you know, like everybody has always told me when I talked about this, without exception, every single one the men of God that I've talked to, they cannot defend it. What do they say? Well, go read this book. 90% of them, it's always not a Baptist. John Wolfer, Dwight Pentecost, you know, all these people who have penned these lengthy discourses on the end times, they never won a soul to Christ. John Wolfer, he's the pastor of Presbyterian Church. You know, he wrote, you know, in the last 100 years, he's one of the works. He was a professor at Dallas Theological Seminary, you know, the big, you know, and they're just cranking out these pre-trib teachers. And so, anyway, there's no way I can never come into a place or even have a discussion and change anybody's mind on this. But here's what Tom Black's admonishing the brethren here is to look into the matter yourself. Hey, ask yourself, how can I prove this doctrine of immanence? That's where it started for me. You know, I couldn't look to these men anymore. I mean, I practically had John R. Rice's Revelation commentary memorized. I love the subject, but you know, I had questions that needed answering, and I didn't get them answered until I looked into the matter myself. And that's my great encouragement for everybody here. And so let's look at another one here. So. Okay, no man knoweth the hour. Proof number 4. Matthew 24:36. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. This is interesting right here. This verse has been quoted to me almost as much time as a thief in the night. Very, very common defense for the imminent return of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what does it mean that we can't know the hour? Does that mean, really, that he could come at any moment? It doesn't. It just means we don't know the hour. And really, there is a difference. And so now, here's a couple more proofs, but I want to get into the whole motive to write this article is a passage that I would like everybody in here to be very familiar with. So proof number 5 is, it's been quoted to me, behold, I come quickly. That also doesn't mean it. It says he's coming quickly, kind of like the phrase at hand. And also, in Acts 1:7, this has been quoted at me many times. Brother Tom, it's not for you to know the times or the seasons. We don't know, I don't know, you don't know, but it's absolutely going to be pre-trib. You know, for some reason, they don't know the times or the seasons, but mark this down. And so I don't mean to, it's very difficult for me not to sound like critical against my brethren when I talk about this, but I promise you, I love Bible Christians, the saints, if you will. And so if I sound kind of like I'm being critical, I accept my apology for that. But mark it down. When it comes to the end times, you're absolutely wrong.
That's right, man.
And somebody needs to say something about it. Thank God for Pastor McMurtry. You know, I'm not a pastor or anything like that, but you know, I know a little bit about his story. It's been uncomfortable for him. But God's going to bless him. You watch. Get on board. And so let's look at the whole reason why I wrote this. I got a little bit of time here. What time do I have to quit, brother?
Quarter till.
Okay, so real quick, I'm going to go back to this thing on no man knoweth the hour. Okay? If you go, everybody turn to Matthew chapter 24 in your Bible. This is interesting. This is really interesting. When I discovered this, let's look at verse 29. I'm going to read immediately after the tribulation. That's a chronological phrase. After the tribulation. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun and the moon shall the sun and the moon be darkened. I'm quoting another verse that I'm familiar with. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be shaken, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming. I would like everybody in here, if you have a pen, to underline or circle that word coming. Okay? It is clear that Jesus Christ is coming in this verse. And we'll come back to this in another way, but do know that in verse 30 of Matthew 24, Jesus is coming. Okay, so now let's go back to no man knoweth the hour. Jesus Christ is coming, and you know what I used to hear, or I still hear it? But this is what I was taught when I went to Bible college. Oh, Brother Tom, Jesus Christ is coming for his own, and then he's coming with his own. And they teach that he's coming with his own here. Mm-hmm. They teach that this is the battle of Armageddon, which is just not true. We'll get into that a little bit later. But he is coming right here. That's what I'm trying to point out. So now let's jump down to verse 36. Now they say that this gathering of the saints that we just read and the coming in the clouds is not a word that I hate, the rapture. Because the rapture is like a word like imminent. It's not found in the Bible. It comes from the Latin. The Latin Vulgate is where they get that, rapture. So why are we stealing a Catholic word to use Baptist doctrine? It's another, and I could go on and on. I could name you like 30 different things just from memory right now. These end times little soundbite doctrine of things that you just can't find in the scripture. Rapture is one of them. And so, okay, I'm on a rabbit trail again. Verse 36, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. See, Brother Tom, you can't know the rapture. Wait a minute. I thought you said that verse 30 is not the rapture. Yeah. Why are you using this verse a few years later to prove that the rapture we can't know in the hour is? Mm-hmm. See, there's a lot of double talk and a lot of double-mindedness going on. And in the past, I couldn't defend it. I just thought, hey, these people know something that I don't know. They're in their Bible. They're men of God. They're ordained. God's blessing them. They're winning souls. I better just shut my mouth. But as the years went on and I kept reading and reading and reading, boy, it was just boiling over in me. Hey, the Bible says, after the tribulation of those days, then shall you see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with power and great glory. I was asking God's men, what coming is that? It says coming. What coming is that? Okay, so now I want you to guys see something awesome. Let's go back to verse 29 again, in Matthew 24. I'm going to point out some things here. Okay, immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming. Okay, he's coming in the clouds, number two. He's going to send his angels with a trumpet. And there's going to be a gathering. I want you to remember those four things. He's coming. He's coming in the clouds. There's going to be a trumpet. And there's a gathering. You know, that's the Bible word. This rapture, for some reason, they're focused on that phrase, caught up. You know, that's how they got to the gathering. The gathering is what I want to be a part of. You know, if I drove to this church, I'm not going to talk about my drive. I want to talk about Tom being gathered here. You know, why are we so focused on the rapture? That's being caught up. That's driving to, 3 hours to come meet here. I want to talk about the gathering. That's the Bible word. Paul uses the exact same word. Now, this is awesome. You guys turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. This was one of those times I had an epiphany, you know. Kent Hogan, he's the one that pointed my feet in the right direction. And I said, well, let me look into this matter because somebody I trust is saying something that goes against what I was taught. But this, when I discovered this, I was in my office. I was studying this. Man, I wanted to come out of my chair. I couldn't believe what I was seeing here. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, we're going to see the exact same things that we just saw in Matthew 24. Let me get through myself. Well, you think I can find Thessalonians? I've been there a few times. All right, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Let's start in verse 16. Or right, let's go back to 15. For this we say unto you, now this is a famous verse, everybody's heard this. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming. See that? Are we talking about the coming?
Yep.
All right, so there's the coming. Let's go down to verse 16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God. Now we have a coming. There's the second thing, there's a trumpet. The dead in Christ shall rise first. We're getting some more details that we didn't get in Matthew chapter 24. But we know it's a parallel passage because we have Jesus coming, we have a trumpet, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds. So we have a gathering in the clouds, there's a trumpet, there's a coming. Folks, Matthew 24 and 1 Thessalonians chapter 14, it's the same event.
Yep.
Jesus
yeah,
is right. coming. And that's what I was asking preachers. Okay, if it's different from the coming in 1 Thessalonians, which one's the second coming? So is the gathering in Matthew 24, is that the third coming?
Oh no, Brother Tom, I never said that.
Well, you've got a trumpet in Matthew 24. You've got clouds in Matthew 24. You've got a gathering in Matthew 24. You've got a coming. So you got four things. And there's more than just four, because if you read the whole passage, there's a lot of other similarities too. In Thessalonians versus the Olivet Discord. Both Paul and Jesus Christ said, let no man deceive you. And there's a whole bunch of them. When you start comparing them, you realize that they're talking about the same event. So I'm not the greatest Bible expositor, and but you know what? I can point out very easily that these four events, it just really opened my eyes. And when I realized that, boy, I put one piece of the puzzle together, and I just started building off of that. And so, let's look at some more things here. So know this, folks. I would like you to circle that word coming in 1 Thessalonians chapter 14 and in Matthew 24. Don't let anybody tell you those are two different events, because they're the same. You know, and I could take you to Revelation chapter 19 where Jesus Christ is coming. But guess what? That word coming is not even found there. He is coming because we use that word in English, but God was very careful not to use that word. You cannot find it. You cannot find the clouds. You cannot find the angels. You cannot find the trumpet. You know, the sun and the moon didn't go dark there, just like in Matthew 24.
Yep.
But what do you have? In at the Battle of Armageddon, you have Jesus arriving on the earth with an army from heaven on white horses. Mm-hmm. You know, we can talk about that some other time, but all those elements are absent. So how are they trying to force Matthew 24 to be the Battle of Armageddon? Can't do it, folks. And that's what they tried to teach me at college. But, you know, and that's why I thought, you know what? I'm kind of an intelligent guy, but I just don't get this. And so, here I am. Okay, so now there's other things here, and I'm just going to quickly read some of these. You'll see there's a short list to refute eminence. There's a whole bunch of things that I want to just point out real briefly. Jesus, right before the Olivet Discord, Matthew 23 at the very end, he was talking to the scribes and the Pharisees. He was just ripping them to shreds, calling them serpents and hypocrites, and he told them, look, temple's going to be destroyed. Every single stone's going to be picked off another, and that was fulfilled by the Roman general Titus in 70 AD. You know, that building got caught on fire, and all the gold melted and fell in between the rocks, Josephus tells us, and they literally picked the stones one off another, chasing that gold down. Jesus predicted that prophetically and told these people that would happen. And guess what? He couldn't have come back before then. That refutes imminence right there, because John R. Rice said in his commentary on Revelation, I was going to bring it, but you know, it says right in that book that Jesus Christ could have come in the Apostle Paul's lifetime. How could that happen? Because the temple would have had to been destroyed before Jesus Christ comes back to fulfill this prophecy. And there's a whole bunch of other things too. I'm gonna talk about all of them. An interesting thing when I was researching this, I was looking up the day of death with Paul and the day of death with John, who wrote the book of Revelation. Now, John died somewhere around 100 AD. He wrote the book of Revelation about 96 AD, which is the date that the experts tend to agree on. Now, Paul died about 67 AD. Now, if John R. Rice was correct and he said Jesus Christ could have come back during Paul's lifetime, then the book of Revelation would have never been written. You see all the contradictions that they have? It's crazy. There's no... Jesus cannot break his word. He cannot lie. There's no chance that Jesus Christ is going to come back before the sun and the moon go dark. Before the temple is destroyed. Before John died, or before Paul dies. The book of Revelation had to be written. So there's just all these things, one after another, folks. And so... let's look at the last thing I'm going to touch on. Let's look where it says, imminence, put the rest permanently. Oh, that's kind of like introduction, folks. This right here, this is the nail in the coffin, if you will, to this imminence doctrine. Let's read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 1. And let me admonish you, folks, to be personally very familiar with this passage. Because this is it. This is the passage that when I quote this to preachers, they don't have a comeback. 99% of them don't anyway. They bite their tongue because the Bible does the work for you. Look what it says. Now we beseech you, brethren, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. We beseech you, brethren, by the coming, okay? We know what we're talking about, right? The coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering. Whoa! See what's going to take place at the coming? There's going to be a gathering. Alright, so we're on the same page. We know what we're talking about. That ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled either by spirit nor by word nor by letter from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. We kind of don't talk like that, but let me tell you what that verse is saying. He's saying, don't be shaken, folks, because the day of Christ is not at hand. Mm-hmm. That's what it says. And if you think it says something else, read it over and over again, and you'll come to that same conclusion. He's saying, don't be shaken. The day of Christ is not at hand. Now, here's where the preachers cannot defend. Look at this next verse. This is it right here, folks. The whole motive for me writing this paper. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day. What day is that? The coming, the gathering. That day shall not come, except two things are going to happen first. There's going to be a falling away, and that the man of sin be revealed. Right there, that destroys this unbiblical word of death imminence. Yeah. There's going to be a falling away first, and the man of sin will be revealed first. Paul's telling these people this. Now, does anybody know when the man of sin is revealed in the 7-year period talked about in the book of Revelation? Does anybody know that? It happens in the midst. 9:27. The man of sin is revealed in the midst of the 70th week of Daniel. It's not the beginning. Like every chart I've ever seen, in any book I've ever seen in the last 100 years, it shows the rapture of the church, and then the tribulation, and then they figured it out that the man of sin is revealed at the midpoint. They've got the rapture happening 3.5 years before that. And it triggers the tribulation. It's not in Scripture, folks.
Nope. Yeah.
And when you start asking these questions to the people that you love, to your dads, to pastor, to your friends, to your cousins, and all the people that you love, and they can't answer the question, it was a process for me that took a few years. But the reason I'm here is just to try to speed it up a little bit. Mm-hmm. Because I can answer those hard questions. I'm going to be at the are depicted, and I said a lot of things, and maybe you disagree with me. And I don't come across as being a humble guy, and I apologize for that, but I promise you this, and my wife can testify, I paid a price in the scriptures. I paid a price before the Lord in prayer, because I don't want to be wrong on this. I'm going to be accountable right now during my life for everything I say. And if I'm going to mislead the brethren to go astray, I don't want that judgment of God on me right now. You know, when I'm judged at the judgment seat of Christ, I'm going to be rewarded for my labors here. But if I'm up here misleading you, I think God's going to judge me right now. And I don't want that. So I want everybody to be informed on this very important doctrine, because the independent Baptist churches that I love, that reached me for Christ, that invested in the Tom Blacks that are here in this town and everywhere else, they're not warning the flock of everything that we read in Matthew chapter 24. There's a ton of warnings in there, and we need to know what they are.
Amen.
And real quick, I've heard that falling away. Now, I don't get into the Greek, and but the Greek word is apostasia. That word simply means apostasy. Now, in this, I can't talk about everything in here, but I want you to keep this and read it. You'll see that I go to the other two places where in the Bible where that term falling away or fell away is. It's a spiritual falling away. You ever see those charts on the internet or in a book where it shows a falling away from the earth? That wouldn't make any sense if Paul said, hey, before there's a falling away, there's going to be a falling away first. Before there's a rapture, there's going to be a rapture first. It makes no sense. But if you look at it plainly, what the Bible's teaching, that day shall not come until there's a falling away and apostasy and the man of sin be revealed. They're just so desperate to come up with something to say, hey, Jesus Christ, we're going to be out of here before the pure persecution starts. That's why I'm up here. That's why I just spent countless hours just studying this to be accountable and to write the Bible word of truth. And boy, there's just so much more to this subject. This is just barely scratching the subject. But one last thing about imminence. Imminence is a pillar required to support this pre-tribulation fairy tale. It's required.
Yep.
We look at a ton of scriptures that, I mean, it just destroys imminence. There's a few other passages that are used for, but these are the most common ones. But now listen, this pillar of imminence that is supporting the pre-trib, you take away imminence, it makes the pre-trib view impossible. They have to have imminence. And we just talked about a few things, and you know, these writings right here, basically, there's a little bit more about the subject. I would encourage you just to read it prayerfully. You know, get in the scriptures on your own. Look up every single one, because this is only a tiny snapshot of my personal study on imminence, but I just wanted to cover the most important ones. And so, hey, thanks for being gracious and hearing me out. I appreciate you guys.
Amen.